Today I want to talk about hemoglobin A1c, the levels, the charts, how to read them, and why A1c may be the single most important marker on a blood test, and yet it's often not even measured. I'm going to explain everything that you need to know. Hey, I'm Dr. Ekberg with Wellness for Life, and if you like to truly master health by understanding how the body really works, make sure that you subscribe and hit that notification bell so that you don't miss anything. A lot of people have heard about A1C and glucose and insulin resistance and diabetes, and they know it's a big deal. So we're going to explain all the different pieces you need to understand to make sense of all of that. So first of all, why is A1C measured? Well, blood sugar is important, but blood sugar can fluctuate tremendously, especially with a diet of refined foods. So if you measure something at a certain time, then you could get a very different reading depending on the time you pick. So measuring glucose is difficult because it changes by the hour or even by the minute. So what they found was that the red blood cells, these are red blood cells, they're floating around in the bloodstream, and if there's a lot of sugar in the bloodstream, meaning high blood glucose, some of that sugar is going to get stuck to the red blood cells, to the hemoglobin. And if there's more sugar in the bloodstream, there's going to be more sugar stuck to the hemoglobin. So they can measure the percentage of hemoglobin with glucose stuck to it, and they come up with a measurement, hemoglobin A1C. So how did they do this? Simply, they took 500 people, they did a long study, they measured the glucose and the A1C at varying times. They plotted all of this and they came up with a remarkably straight line. So they knew that there was a very strong correlation, a very tight relationship between glucose and A1C. Then they came up with a formula. So now we can measure one marker, A1C, and get an average of what the average glucose is, because a red blood cell lives about 3 to 4 months, and during its lifetime, it gets more and more sugar, more and more glucose stuck to it. So depending on how much glucose is stuck, we can measure and figure out pretty much exactly what the average glucose was. So now we have a much, much better measurement, because even if it goes up and down a lot, we can still figure out what it was on average. And that's much more important to know than knowing what it was over here or over here. So now we can create a chart and we can figure out, we know that an average glucose of 91 is equivalent to an A1C of 4.8. Average glucose of 100 is equivalent to a 5.1, and so on. And they have defined normal as being anything up to a 5.7. Between 5.7 and 6.4 is pre-diabetes. That means that you don't have diabetes yet, but you're probably going to get it. And above 6.4 or 6.5, 6.5 and up, is called diabetes. They've defined that as diabetes. But here's the thing to understand, that even though they have imposed these sharp delineations, they've put these limits and say, here it is this thing and here it's something else, it's all gradual, okay? Here it does very little damage and here it does a tremendous amount of damage, because we know diabetes, it's just a label at when it's got over a certain point, but diabetes is associated with blindness, with amputations, and with kidney failure. It's the leading cause of all those things. It's devastating in today's society. But if we understand that the higher the number, the more of these complications we have, then we also understand that a 6.4 is not as good as a 5.1. There's a huge difference. So we don't want to just look at this number and say, oh good, I'm normal. If we're after optimum health, we want to understand this and try to bring it into the optimal range, which in my experience and opinion and belief is somewhere between 4.8 and 5.1. So then people say, well, I had on my last blood test, they measured my glucose and it came back at a 90. So does that mean I have an A1C of 4.8? No, because when they measured the glucose, That means that was your fasting glucose level. They caught it at a certain time, and we don't know where on that scale it was. But if you have an average glucose of 100, that means a lot of times it's going to need to be lower than that, and sometimes it's going to be higher than that. So for example, if you wake up in the morning and you have a fasting level of 80, and then you eat something, like something healthy, like an omelet or some avocado, then it's probably going to go up a little bit, but not tremendously. It's probably going to stay in the 120 range. And then as your body digests this over several hours, it's going to gradually come back down again. Your average level there might have been 100, even though your fasting level was an 80. So that's the thing with the A1C. It measures the average. So on a good day, it will look like this. For people who aren't quite so healthy, but still considered normal, they might look something like this. So they wake up and they're starving, they have hypoglycemia, they're lightheaded, no energy, they need to get something in them before they start functioning. And so they have some cereal and a donut and low-fat milk, and now it jumps up to 180. And then it comes crashing down because of all the insulin required to get this blood sugar out. And it comes up and down throughout the day. And yet their average is 120, which by the official guidelines is still normal. It is not even pre-diabetic, but this is not healthy because this is toxic to the brain and this level is toxic to the brain. So here's sort of how it works. This is not an absolute, but just like a scenario to give you an idea. Normal would be average of 100 and within a very tight range. Then we start eating some processed foods and the blood sugar goes crazy. But when it comes crashing down, the body still has some reserves. We release some cortisol to bring up the blood sugar. The liver is working so it can break down some glycogen and get the blood sugar up so we never totally crash. But if we keep doing this, now we develop even larger swings. And at the bottom here, we get something called reactive hypoglycemia because now the organs are a little too tired. They're a little worn out to keep up with this abuse. So now we get even bigger swings. But we're still considered normal, maybe pre-diabetic. Maybe we're getting into this range. And then eventually, the system just can't keep up at all. It can't get the sugar out of there quickly. So now we have type 2 diabetes, maybe insulin dependent or non-insulin dependent. But the blood sugar is so high on average, so consistently high, that the pancreas can't create enough insulin to push this out into the cell. So now, even though there's some swings, we have a steady high level and we're in diabetes. So again, it doesn't happen like this every time, but it's just a scenario of how these things can happen over time. So what we want to understand is that even if the average isn't too terribly bad, we're still creating damage. We're still not producing energy at a steady level. We're not functioning at our optimum, and we're still developing inflammation with all this insulin. So there's lots and lots of different drawbacks to this scenario over this, even though we're still considered in the normal range. And the other thing to understand about A1C is that because these blood cells live about 3 to 4 months, these values don't change very quickly. So if someone says, how do I bring down my A1C as fast as possible? Well, you start eating real food, you avoid the sugar and the starches, but it's still gonna take a while because let's say you start off with a blood sugar of 180. And if you kept it there for a while, then your A1C would be about 8. So you realize, hey, I'm killing myself. This is not a good thing. Let me change. So you start eating real food. And after a month, your average blood sugar, as they measured with frequent pinpricks, is about 150. And then in month 3, it's 125, and in month 4, it's 100. So then you go and you figure, oh, look, I'm going to go get checked, and my A1C should be about 5. No, it's not going to be, because you still have some of the blood cells from previous months that were still swimming around while your blood sugar was really high. So even if you follow this scenario and you're getting very healthy very quickly, your A1C is going to be maybe 6.5. So the moral of the story is, yes, you definitely want to do this, but the A1C blood test may not reflect the true value because it's lagging behind. If you get a 6.5 after 4 months, you're actually doing a whole lot better than this 6.5 is indicating. So be patient with it and realize that this is something you definitely want to keep track of, but it's not something that's going to change very quickly. You want to have at least a 6 or 9 month horizon on getting this leveled out. So we don't do a whole lot of blood work in our office, but I think there's a few markers that are worth keeping track of and maybe at least get a baseline so that you know where you're starting, so you know what's been going on. And A1C is one of those markers that we highly recommend and that we suggest for people to get. So while I was searching for a few questions on Google, it dawned on me how many misconceptions there are out there. So one of the questions was, what's a good A1C if you have type 2 diabetes? There is no answer to that because it is never good with diabetes. But the problem is people have been labeled, they have been said, oh look, you have an A1C of 7 or 8, you are diabetic, here's your medication. Instead of understanding that this is physiology, this is an adaptation, your body has adapted to a long-term insult, and if you stop the insult, your body can reverse it. So there is no good A1C level for diabetes. The only good way is to reverse the diabetes by giving your body some real food and some good exercise and a healthy environment. And other people are asking, how do I bring down my A1C quickly? And again, we sort of talked about this, that it isn't going to go quick because there's going to be a lag, but regardless, you're going to have to do the right things to get your body healthy. That's the only way that you can develop health and sustain health. We want to get rid of that idea of a quick fix. Okay, you have to address the underlying conditions. You have to handle the cause of the problem. And I can't tell you how often I have people come into the office and they say, oh, you know, I have diabetes, but my doctor says it's being controlled. All right. What that means is that they are managing to keep it at an 8 or a 9 instead of a 14. So they're not going to develop as quickly, as terrible complications as if they didn't do anything. But that's not a solution. That's not keeping it in control. We have to understand that the body can heal if we do the right things. And the right things is to not listen to government guidelines, because they believe that grains and sugar and processed foods are necessary in moderation. Okay? If you want to reverse this, then you get off of sugar, you get off of all the white flour, but also you get off of all the grain and all the processed foods. You base your food on vegetables, you fill in with some protein, and then you eat healthy fats until you're full. That's how you reverse this stuff. Because if you stop putting things in the body that will cause blood sugar spikes, then you will start reversing this situation. And what we've been talking about is a big problem, because there is probably less than 10% of the population that are in a good level, somewhere between 4.8 and 5.1. We have 50% or so at a level above 5.7. But again, in my mind, I think 5.5 to 5.7 is like pre-diabetes. It's not a place you want to be if you're looking for optimum health. Just because something becomes normal in the sense that most people have it, that doesn't make it a good idea or healthy. Just because you don't have symptoms yet doesn't make it healthy. So please share this information with as many people as you can, because the more we can get the truth out about how the body works and the optimum lifestyle, the better we can help people have quality of life. If you have any questions, let me know. I'll be more than happy to answer questions or make videos on additional topics. And if you have some experiences, if you've been measuring your A1Cs and you have some feedback for me, please share that as well. I'd love to hear from you. Thanks so much for watching.